Before we go directly to the Word, I must admit I wasn't really even totally shocked that the devil would try to do something today in regards to my voice or to get me so that I wouldn't be able to speak. But he ought to have learned, to my knowledge, never at any point in time have I let it stop me through all these years. There have been times when literally the person sitting beside me could not hear me, and I've stood up and preached. And the Lord would let his anointing, and the further I go along, you'll see it's going to get better and better. That's just the way it is. And I thank him for it. Amen, church?
Amen.
Hallelujah. Okay. Today, my goodness gracious, we are ending this journey that we have been on, beginning in John chapter 13. And today, as we continue with that, we went through chapter 17, verses 1 through 19. There is not a greater prayer prayed in this Bible than the one that we are now looking at, done by the Lord Jesus himself on our behalf. What an amazing, amazing prayer. And then as we come to the culmination of it today, there are only six verses today. So we begin with verse 20 and end, of course, with verse 26. So I entitled this today, "So That the World Might Believe." So that the world might believe. So these particular verses and where we find ourselves and everything since John chapter 13, I've seen moving toward a climax that the Lord is bringing us to. You may not see it that way, and if you don't, that's fine. I see so many hidden things in the scriptures pertaining to where we are and what's happening. So we'll jump right in, so that the world may believe. We've been with Jesus now for a good number of weeks, and now the end is near. He's been in the upper room. They've left there. They've gone down to Gethsemane as he's making his way to that encounter, as he has one more talking with his Lord, his Father. Those men that have been with him have given more than 3 years of their lives to him, with him, to follow him and to be prepared. Now they're being prepared for a future without him. How those disciples must have felt. Their reason for living was saying he was leaving them. The audacity. They didn't understand it. They couldn't handle it. So Jesus took a lengthy heart-to-heart talk with them and then surprised them by lifting his eyes to heaven and praying aloud to the Father and let them hear it. Amen. Following the pattern of what they knew of the high priest pattern in Leviticus 16, his intercession. They knew about it. He prayed for himself first, then for those 11 men. So they were listening to all this happen. And so as we come to John 17, verses 20 through 26, he concludes his prayer by extending his intercession far beyond the horizon of his own lifetime. He prays for those who will believe in me through their this apostle's word. I'm praying for you. Amen. We see the answer to this prayer in the book of Acts, as you read the book of Acts, and throughout the New Testament epistles. But Jesus takes it a step further, church. He prayed for generations of disciples. Amen. That's who we are, right down to mine and your time. For it is through the ministry of the apostles, my friends, that we ourselves have ultimately come to be the Lord's disciples because of them. Jesus entrusted his entire future of his ministry, if we can put it that way, to that group of ordinary, stumbling men. That's amazing. Jesus, the Messiah, left his ministry for them to carry it on. Well, look at you. He left his ministry with us. Amen. I said he left his entire ministry to those of us who call ourselves disciples. And I'm not talking about preachers and teachers. I'm talking about us. That our title is nothing other than I am a disciple of the Lord Jesus Christ. His entire ministry of bringing people out of darkness into light, he left in our hands. That's pretty astounding. That's pretty frightening when you look at what we've done with it. John 17, 20 through 21. I do not ask for these only, but also for those who will believe in me through their word, that they may all be one, just as you, Father, are in me and I in you, that they also may be in us, so that the world may believe that you have sent me. It was critically important, church, for these 11 men to continue the ministry that Jesus had started. He knew that the spreading of the gospel around the world would not end with those 11 men, but it had to start with them. They were the starting of the ministry. Thousands down through the ages would echo their teachings of salvation. Jesus went to Calvary, died, rose again, ascended into heaven, knowing that what he had started would absolutely survive. He knew it. And thrive. He knew it. Church, on that day, though we can't really comprehend it, he knew it would be a disciple. He knew then what he wanted for you and prayed it. So if he prayed something for us, don't you think we better pay attention to it? John 17.
I do not ask for these only, but also for those who will believe in me through their word, that they may all be one, just as you, Father, are in me and I in you, that they also may be in us, so that the world may believe that you have sent me.
The kind of unity that Jesus prophesied over his body was to be patterned after the same unity that he had with his Father. That's pretty outstanding. Just as the Father and the Son are one through the power of the Holy Spirit, every believer was soon to be indwelled by that very same Holy Spirit. Then the very same, the fellowship of Christians with each other, would naturally develop into a mirror image of the perfect unity and fellowship that the Father and Son had. Just as you, Father, are in me, and I in you. Paul understood this and wrote it to the Colossians. Colossians 3:11.
Here there is not Greek and Jew, circumcised and uncircumcised, barbarian, Scythian, slave, free, but Christ is all and in all.
So from the Bible's point of view, the fellowship we have with each other transcends all natural and social connections, distinctions, and divisions. What actually lies behind this prayer comes from the teaching Jesus had already given the disciples. And it would take some time for them to process it. See, every brother and sister in Christ is a gift from the Father to Jesus. We learned that last week. But they're also a gift from the Father to you. See, I've said this for so many years, and we have not paid attention to it much. We desperately need each other. We are not an island by ourselves. We need mixture. We need who we are to come together so that we can be complete. We are incomplete without each other. There's nothing like when we come together in the house and worship of God, and we are united based on the principle that we've been born again. Amen. That we are part of God's family. That's who we are. Amen. And we'd quit looking down our noses at this and that and church. Jesus is coming back. Amen. And we're still on the same stupid things. Paul said it in 1 Corinthians 12, 18 through 21.
But as it is, God arranged the members in the body, each one of them, as he chose. If all were a single member, where would the body be? As it is, there are many parts, yet one body. The eye cannot say to the hand, I have no need of you. Nor again the head to the feet, I have no need of you.
Jesus looked at those 11 men and prayed that they may be one. I mean, it's hard to be one with your own family in your own house and everybody in the house calling themselves Christian. Something's wrong. Something's wrong. And until we recognize something is wrong, we're not going to change it. Surely Jesus must have had great faith when he prayed that they may be one. I mean, Lord have mercy. Can I get an amen on that one? Now, this is why this petition. Why did he do it? Why not pray that they may be strong and courageous, or that they may be eloquent in their witness? Why didn't he do that? Amen. This petition is so important that Jesus himself tells us why. This is his last prayer over us. And this is what he says in John 17, 21.
That they may all be one, just as you, Father, are in me and I in you, that they also may be in us, so that the world may believe that you have sent me.
Now, wait a minute. Did you catch it? Yeah. I don't know if you caught it. That they may be one. This is what you should have caught. So that the world may believe. Do you see the value of this?
Yes.
This is Jesus.
Yes.
Let them be one so that the world may believe in Jesus. Maybe you never thought about it this way, but in this amazing prayer, Jesus gave us the most powerful evangelistic tool we have, and most of the church world has totally and completely missed it for generations.
No matter how hopeless, overwhelmed, or out of control your life may feel, there's still a place to run for help. Sandra has compiled 6 teachings through which you'll learn how you can break the cycle of stress and anxiety and live in victory. The 4 CD series, Make No Room for Hopelessness, includes 6 sessions teaching how your situation is never without hope. Order offer 143 and learn how to let God handle your problem so you can have peace in your life.
The Lord's perspective is that each local church would be powerful, be a powerful evangelistic agency by demonstrating such a love and unity among themselves that a hostile and competitive world would absolutely shake their heads in disbelief that the relationships Christians have with each other would make a powerful evangelistic impact upon a self-centered and arrogant world. That's what happened in the book of Acts. It was the way they lived that changed the world. It wasn't what they did. It's what they did based on what they believed and how they lived. Acts 2:42.
And they devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and the fellowship, to the breaking of bread and the prayers. And awe came upon every soul. And many wonders and signs were being done through the apostles, and all who believed were together and held all things in common. And they were selling their possessions and belongings and distributing the proceeds to all as any had need. And day by day, attending the temple together and breaking bread in their homes, they received their food with glad and generous hearts, praising God and having favor with all the people. And the Lord added to their number day by day those who were being saved.
When the Lord adds to you, I promise you at that time, then most of the division goes out the door. The problem happens to us is it's not the Lord adding sometimes. I mean, many times we're added because of a prosperity message. Many times we're added because of something that we can get out of it instead of how we can give to it. Now, you and I have traditionally viewed evangelism as one or two ways. As the ministry of a called evangelist who travels around preaching and teaching the message of salvation, or as the personal witness of a believer to a non-believer. But interesting enough, I promise you, everybody should be witnessing, but that's not the point. Look at what Peter said, 1 Peter 3:15.
But in your hearts, honor Christ the Lord as holy, always being prepared to make a defense to anyone who asks you for a reason for the hope that is in you, yet do it with gentleness and respect.
Church, in this prayer, Jesus makes a strong case that the church family is God's chief instrument of evangelism. I promise you, in a culture like ours, defined by individualism, alienation, and fragmentation, the demonstration of a fellowship of disciples walking in love with each other is a powerful tool for igniting a curiosity and hunger for the kind of relationship the world continually fails to offer. In a world that is tearing to shreds the foundations on which life is meant to be built, unsaved people who encounter an entirely different world within the context of a vibrant church cannot ignore what they're witnessing. Are you beginning to see what was on Jesus' mind as he prayed? John 17:21.
That they may all be one, just as you, Father, are in me and I in you. That they also may be in us, so that the world may believe that you have sent me.
You know, for so long we've wanted selfish unity in the church because there's a whole lot nicer than fighting. We've also wanted unity so that we get our corporate prayers answered. Those are okay motivations. But we may not have realized that unity is not first and foremost about us, though we do enjoy the blessings of it. Unity in the body is for showing the world a different way to live. Yes. For making the world jealous for the kind of relationships that the world can never deliver. The world cannot solve the problems. The world cannot heal the hurts. The world cannot make us embrace each other. The world cannot make us conquerors. The world can't help me. The world can't heal my hurts. The world can't empower me so that I can get up and go again. The world can't do it. Jesus can. If every disciple in a local church walked according to the Spirit and not according to the flesh, wouldn't we have such a profound unity that even the angels would marvel at us? We're perhaps too quick to point the finger that the devil is the one, you know, who brought about discord and competition and division in the church. Now, he does that. But it's our fleshly habits, my friend, and choices that open the door to let him in.
Amen. Amen.
Do you remember what the devil, what the Bible calls the devil? The accuser of the brethren?
Uh-huh.
And he's good at his job. And as long as we can keep any of us focused on what we judge to be faults, weaknesses, immaturities in those around us, we'll walk in the flesh and not in the spirit, leaving us in an atmosphere where unity cannot thrive. Paul wrote it to the Corinthians, 2 Corinthians 5:16.
From now on, therefore, we regard no one according to the flesh, even though we once regarded Christ according to the flesh, we regard him thus no longer.
You do realize, don't you? And most of the time, what irritates you the most about someone else is the very thing you do yourself. That's the time to pray, Lord, is what I think I see in my brother or sister actually in me? Am I seeing it in them because it's really in me? You know, a regular dose of humility helps us all. What Jesus is praying for is a powerful unity, a purpose, and our shared commitment to walk in his ways so that we become transformed into the image of his dear son, both individually and as a church family. Paul had this on his mind when he wrote to a very diverse church made up of Jewish and Gentile believers. They couldn't get along no matter how hard they tried. Ephesians 4:1-3.
I therefore, a prisoner for the Lord, urge you to walk in a manner worthy of the calling to which you have been called, with all humility and gentleness, with patience, bearing with one another in love, eager to maintain the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace.
Ephesians 4:2-3. It's a list and it's a way, the attitudes that you need to have in order to cultivate how to live in the kind of unity that Jesus is talking about. Humility, considering others more important than yourself, having a servant's heart. Gentleness, keeping our minds and emotions under control, guarding our thoughts. Patience, self-restraint, refusing to lash out or retaliate. Bearing with one another, putting up with the shortcomings of others without embarrassing them. Love, loving them as Jesus has loved them. Keeping the unity, guarding and keeping the unity Jesus has already given us. Avoiding anything that would distract from unity. The bond of peace, unconditionally accepting each other because of our union in the Spirit. These qualities, Paul insists, will give such credibility to the gospel that the world can't help but take notice and ultimately be attracted to the gospel of Jesus Christ. John 17:22-23.
The glory that you have given me, I have given to them, that they may be one, even as we are one. I and them and you and me, so that they may become perfectly one, so that the world may know that you sent me and loved them even as you loved me.
Jesus continues to pray, continues to ask, you know, that the unique anointing of glory that he's imparted to his disciples may accomplish its work by making them unified, that even the world will have to acknowledge that God loves his disciples, even as or in the same way that he loves Jesus. That's pretty amazing. The Father loves you as much as he loves Jesus. I can't understand it. But we need to believe it because he can't lie. Jesus is the one who said it, and he can't lie. John 17:24.
Father, I desire that they also whom you have given me may be with me where I am, to see my glory that you've given me, because you loved me before the foundation of the world.
As we move to a closing, we've talked so much about the rapture and look forward to it, but I want you to notice what Jesus said in verse 24. We just read it. It says, Father, I desire that they also, whom you have given me, may be with me where I am. Did you get that? That Jesus desires for the rapture to take place? Did you see it? If we're desiring for the rapture to take place, we're on good ground. Jesus longs to have us with him. Had it ever occurred to you that he's more interested in the rapture than you are?
Amen.
He's more excited about the rapture than you are? After all, he knows what's waiting for you. He's the one who created it. He's the one who has prepared everything for you. Jesus ends his amazing prayer with a triumphant declaration. John 17:25-26.
O righteous Father, even though the world does not know you, I know you, and these know that you have sent me. I made known to them your name, and I will continue to make it known, that the love with which you have loved me may be in them and I in them.
Those words spoken more than 2,000 years ago. This prayer of Jesus is as fresh and relevant today as the night that he prayed it, that night in Gethsemane. Since we are among those whom he prayed for, there are 8 things that I want you to remember. 1, remember that just as he prayed for Peter, he prays for you. 2, remember that the Father always hears his prayers, including his prayers for you. Talking about the prayers of Jesus. 3, remember that he has made known his Father's name to you, and he has brought you into his family. 4, remember that he loves you with the same love his Father has for him. 5, remember that the beloved Son of the Father dwells in you through his Holy Spirit. 6, remember that he has given you his word. 7, remember that he has made known his will, which is that he wants you to be with him in glory.
Hallelujah.
Number 8, and remember finally that all of this is recorded so that his joy might be in you and that your joy might be full.